So we'll talk about intraoperative drugs, how much? As you know, anesthetic pharmacology is pharmacology in obese patients is challenging, and sometimes you can use total body weight, but because of the lipophilic characteristic of anesthetic drugs and the high distribution volume in obese patients, you have to take in account select weight scalars or use opioid-free anesthesia to avoid overdose. Here's a schematic summary of obesity-related physiologic changes that may alter anesthetic drugs' behavior. And you can see for cardiovascular function, there is an increase. Cardiac output can alter early drug distribution. For the renal function, there is an altered glomerular filtration rate may impair drug excretion. For the hepatic function, there is an alteration of microenzyme cytochrome P450, that means being induced or antagonized, leading to altered metabolism. And in the skin, there is also a reduced perfusion, may slow uptake of subcutaneous drug administration. Here in red, you have anesthetic consideration and palliative challenge that Samir talked about just a few minutes ago. And you can see there are cardiovascular disease that increase risk for hypertension and coronary artery disease. There is also a gastroesophageal reflux disease at increased risk for aspiration. An endocrine disease at increased risk for hyperglycemia. There is more venous thromboembolism with more increased risk of deep venous thrombosis or pulmonary embolism. And obese patients have also, as Samir said, a redundant upper airway tissue, and more patients have obstructive sleep apnea and increased risk of difficult airway. And as Professor Jaber says, there is a redundant tissue over chest and abdomen with a reduced functional residual capacity that may require increased airway pressure to ventilate. That's why there are recommended weight scalars for selected intravenous anesthetics. As you can see, there are many formulas, and some of them are very complex. But in clinical routine, clinicians use total body weight for, and it's recommended for midazolam, etomidate, succinylcholine, and sufentanil. And for the others, they use ideal body weight with a complex formula. But if you want to use a more simple one, it's 8 less 100 in routine. And it's used for neuromuscular blocking agents like ricuronium, vericuronium, cisatracuronium, and sugammadex. Many clinicians use ideal body weight for propofol, and but it's recommended to take an adjusted body weight with this formula, or a loading dose titrated to target processed EEG level if you have the bispectral index. You see that if you use remifentanil, not in TCI, you have to use fat-free mass with a very complex formula and pharmacokinetic mass for fentanyl. For the other anesthetic drugs, for hypnotics, for example, tiopental and etomidate, it's ideal body weight. If you use target control infusion, that we use in our center, you can use March model for propofol. But what we have to know is the most used one for remifentanil is the Minto model, but it included only a few obese patients in the model dataset. And that's why recently Kim and Hal have developed a new model, but it's not practiced in clinically routine because the syringes are not done for that. For the opioid, if you use sufentanil, it's a total body weight, as I say before. And for morphine, there is a lean body weight formula to use it. For neuromuscular blockers, I repeat that it's total body weight for succinylcholine, and for the others, it's ideal body weight. If you use local anesthetics, it has not been well studied, but we recommend that you use the smallest effective dose to do that. And for inhaled anesthetics, some studies recommend desflurane because there is a quicker recover and a better washout. But you can use also sevoflurane and isoflurane. And that's why we want to say today that if you want to avoid overdose, you can use the opioid-free anesthesia concept in your beds. As you know, opioid-free anesthesia concept induce a diminution of inflammation, an inhibition of metabolic stress, and absence of immunosuppression and autonomous nervous system control. The gold standard for OFA is locoregional anesthesia, but as you know, for bariatric surgery, it's not used, and it's general anesthesia which is used. And you can use for OFA many pathways to reach this. So you can use intravenous lidocaine for its anti-inflammatory effect. You can use ketamine and recently magnesium for anti-hyperalgesic effect. You can use also sympatholytics with alpha-2-agonists like dexmedetomidine. But if you want to be more cost effective, you can use clonidine also and beta blockers. And you have to take into account ideal body weight for this. And after, you have to use multimodal anesthesia with dexamethasone, acetaminophen, nefopam, non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, and gabapentin. And all these concepts is called opioid-free anesthesia. And I want to show what we're doing at our center at Nîmes. It's a less opioid-free anesthesia, which is called opioid-spared anesthesia. And we do this protocol for all the sleeve gastrectomy and bypass surgery. We do the last day before the intervention, a premedication with esomeprazole, 40 milligrams, for its anti-acid effects. But there is no literature to support that. It's only in our center that we use that, but we found a better result. At the induction, we do a mix of dexmedetomidine and lidocaine and ketamine with a dose calculated by ideal body weight. After, we put magnesium and esomeprazole and propofol and remifentanil at Minto model at 0.5 to obtain opioid-spared anesthesia. And we do a rapid second induction with recuronium at the dose of 1.2 milligram per kilo. After, for the maintenance, we do a mixed drug with alpha-2 agonist with dexmedetomidine, lidocaine, and ketamine with 1 milliliter per 10 kilos total body weight. It's total body weight was taken for 4 hours after we infuse that in the SSP. After, for maintenance, we put norepinephrine to maintain a mean arterial pressure under 65. And desflurane or some sevoflurane also with 1 mAC and remifentanil. And most of the time, we don't have to maintenance rocuronium. We do only one dose. But if you want to have maintenance, you can use at this dose. And after 30 minutes before the hand of an anesthesia, we do a multimodal analgesia with acetaminophen, non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, nefopam and droperidol. So if I want to let you two take home message, you have to take in account ideal body weight and why not use opioid free anesthesia. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Jerome, for this very interesting talk with a protocol to apply maybe in practice as you do daily. Before the question for your talk, we have another question for Samir Jaber, which is arrived while we were talking, Jerome. It's from Aurelia. Is there any place for respiratory physiotherapy in the perioperative management of obese patients. Do you think that the physiotherapy is useful?
Yes, I think that is probably one of the major management for mainly abdominal surgery, whatever the type of abdominal surgery, but this is true for all surgery, that more and more the surgery very close to the diaphragm, that means thoracic surgery, abdominal surgery, and all type of surgery, I think physiotherapy with a dedicated team is probably one of the key points of the better outcome.
Okay. Thank you very much. Eric, do you use a different protocol than Jérôme in Belgium, for example? Do you use opioid, spared, or free?
But for obese patient, I perform OFA, such same protocol without remifentanil.
Okay. And, so same protocol yes. without remifentanil, yes. And is it okay for the pain of the obese
Absolutely,
patient?
Yes.
And for every type of surgery, or focus on bariatric surgery?
Certainly for bariatric surgery, and for more painful surgeries like severe spine surgery or something like that, an opioid spare would be better, certainly.
Okay.
I have a question for both and for all the group. The OFA strategy, it's absolutely very exciting for the future because, as presented nicely by Jérôme, the positive effect for both patients, obese and non-obese patients. My question is specifically for abdominal surgery. Do you or the surgeon, use local anesthetic infiltration in the site yes. of the surgery? What type of drug do you use? What quantity? Do you have do you increase the volume for a better diffusion? What is your strategy and what you recommend for the surgeon or anesthesia to probably to improve this strategy? Do you have some recommendation for our colleagues?
Thank you, Samir, for this excellent question. Yes, we use, we perform the local infiltration by the surgeon, and we use naropain 0.2, and as you say, to have a better distribution volume in the abdominal cavity, and we do that at the end of the surgery, and maybe it's a good point to have less pain in operating
room. Because the effect is probably decrease the opioid post-surgery, probably improve the respiratory function due to less drugs, you improve probably the recovery.
Yeah.
This is, we have now some data in non-obese patient, and probably in obese patient we can have the same feeling in the practice.
Yes, that's it.
I don't know if, Eric, you have similar
yes.
approach? And
absolutely, for surgery and infiltration, or if possible, I see for orthopedic surgery, we perform a lot of peripheral nerve block, and
yes.
the actual is to have a very low concentration of anesthetic local, but large volume.
For example, what is exactly your practice? Can you give the... really what you do for the colleagues?
For a total knee, total hip replacement, for example, we use naropain at 0.2 and surgeon infiltrate with 200 milliliters to have the whole cavity of the hip.
This is exactly very similar for us.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So.